Okay guys, let me just walk you very briefly through all the changes I've made to this scenario. So here I've just put some history of the Pacific War so you can refer to it when you're playing. Alright, so these are the units that will be available to both parties. Okay, so Japan has infantry, which is the normal doughboy, raider, which is the partisan, several other units. Okay, they have an old fashioned tank, the 95 Hago. What else do I have? They have several ship classes, several destroyer classes, cruisers, battleships, submarines. And the USA has the same. The Marines are better than the Doughboys, right? So the Marines are better than the Japanese infantry. Marine Raiders are also going to be then the better than the Partisans, the Raiders of the Japanese. The UDT is a renamed SAS Commando with special skills, special qualities. I will go back to it later. Several air units, Brewster Buffalo, Curtis Warhawk, and so on. Destroyer and cruiser classes. Right. So, one of the special features I have introduced here is when you control 7 bases or more, then you will unlock a Sherman tank. Right? You can also switch between a Sherman high explosive tank and a Sherman flamethrower tank when you type HE or flame. From 8 bases onward, you will be able to have access to better fighter planes, right? What was there? On the carriers and Curtis Helldiver also. From 9 bases onward, you will have a better land-based fighter, the P-38 Lightning instead of the Warhawk. From 10 bases onward, you will have access to snipers. From 11 bases onward, you will have access to yet another better carrier fighter and carrier life bomber. Well, I have just combined them into one, right? 12 bases onward, you'll be able to use howitzers. From 14 bases onward, you'll be able to use medics. And finally, from 16 bases onward, you'll be able to drop nuclear bombs, right? Let's have a look at some changes I have done to the unit statistics. So, in the Japanese roster, the AA gun will have a range of 12. I have also slightly increased the ranges of the towers here. The naval mine has 90,000 hit points, so you cannot, well, you can, but it will take you ages to just get rid of them by firing at them with cruisers or destroyers. What else? It's not that important here. Well, machine guns, I've made them a bit slower and given them a longer range. I have increased the area effect of the mortars so that finally they have some, you know, explosions all around. Artillery has also increased range. What else? I have generally increased the flight time of many planes. What else? These are just some name changes. And again, the AA guns of the USA also have the same range, 12. The partisans, so I call them the marine raiders, have an increased line of sight, increased range, increased speed, increased reload speed, so the reload time is down by 30%, they can fire faster, they have extra hit points, they have extra attacks, so they are very strong. They are still weaker than marines, but they'll be stronger than the Japanese infantry doughboys. So the UDT, which stands for the Underwater Demolition Team. These were basically the predecessors of the Navy SEALs. They have an increased line of sight and they can now defuse naval mines. So if you move them close to a naval mine, they will defuse it, right? That's why you shouldn't. Because I really didn't like it when people were always firing at naval mines with ships. Immediately we're able to get rid of them, right? So you have to defuse them here. What else? Yeah, the flamethrowers, extra attack. Fire much faster so that they are finally useful for something. Bazookas plus 600% increase of attack, so they are much stronger, but they also reload much more slowly. Yeah. What else do we have here? I've increased all the flight times of many planes. These are just some name changes. Of course, the Catalina plane, yes. It has a much, much, much longer flight time and a much bigger line of sight, so you can use them to discover ships all around the ocean, because the map is really big. So let's have a look at the map. This is the map from the game. I have used the biggest map available, 400x400. And yeah, you will be starting around here. This is the USA, right? The West Coast. It looks very small, but there's enough space, don't worry. Here's Japan, the Philippines, key islands of Okinawa, Iwo Jima, Mariana Islands, which is Saipan, and this is Guam, Tinian, Saipan, right? The Truk Archipelago, Philippine Islands, Luzon, Samar, Leyte, Mindanao. There are some others, Panay and Negros, I'm not sure about all of them. The Palau Islands, right? So this is the island of Palau, the biggest one. This is the smallest one in the south, the smaller one in the south. Paleleo, I've made it much bigger here so that anything fits on it, right? Here we have the Moratai and Moluk's Island. Rabaul, right? So the new, what is it called? New Britain, New Ireland with the city. I think it's a city of Rabaul. Kavieng also here. We have New Guinea with Port Moresby here. This is the Owen Stanley mountain range all across it. The Solomon Islands with Guadalcanal, a little bit bigger than it should be, but yeah, so that you can place anything on it. Marshall Islands here with, what was the name? I think Kwajalein around here. Gilbert Islands with Tarawa around here. Tarawa Atoll. Right, Midway, the Hawaiian Islands. That's it. So it's a really big map. Alright, so I have changed several game mechanics as well, so let's have a look. First of all, how do you capture bases? So each base, that means each group of islands, for example the Marshall Islands, will have several flags on it, okay? And when you move one human unit near the flag for at least 2 seconds, and then you capture the flag, alright? And also that the surrounding buildings will turn neutral. So that means that once you capture the island, the towers stop shooting at you. Or once you capture the flag. Alright, and when you capture all the flags that belong to one of the bases, that's mostly around 3 flags, and if there are no enemy units on any of the islands belonging to it, then you have captured the whole base. And after 60 seconds, all the buildings will turn under your control, okay? When you capture just one flag, then all the defensive buildings around the flag will stop shooting at you. But you need to capture all the 3 flags, or 2 flags, depending, so that you are able to take control of the crucial buildings here. And very simple, if you capture all 17 bases, so all these 17 island groups, then you win the game. Second, the buildings. So let's talk about the buildings. You cannot build any productive buildings in this scenario, but when you capture one of the bases I have mentioned, then you will gain control over strategically important buildings. For example, airfields, docks, naval yards, barracks and hospitals, right? So not every island base has all of these buildings. They are distributed. They are distributed all over the map. Right, so you can only build ships and planes in the USA, so near the West Coast, or on Hawaii. And all other airfields and docks and naval yards can be used only to repair and harbor your planes and ships, right? So when you select an airport and dock or naval yard outside of the home area, so outside of Hawaii or the USA, then the technology will be removed for all the buildings on the map. So even planes and ships that are already in your production chain will be aborted, so be careful. So the resources will also not be returned, right? So when you are producing something near Hawaii or near the USA, then don't click on any other similar buildings anywhere else on the map, because it will also abort It will remove the technology and it will abort all units in the production chains. That also goes for aircraft carriers, so they can only produce planes near Hawaii or near the west coast. Okay, so it's the same warning for you. When you're producing aircraft carrier planes, you need to make sure that your carriers are within this area between Hawaii and the USA. And you should not click on any other carriers anywhere else on the map during that time, otherwise those planes that are in the production chain will be aborted. Alright, so here, the flight time of many planes has been increased, but if you want to use land-based aircraft successfully, especially bombers, you will have to capture strategically located airfields on some of these islands, right? So look at the map and plan which of the island groups you're going to capture first, because resources are going to be limited. So you can see, you will be able to see where there are naval yards, docks, and airfields, and you should capture those depending on when you will need them in your scenario. Also, there are some hospitals, right, and barracks. Barracks are very few, but there are some hospitals around as well, so you can only heal your units there because medics will be disabled until you have 14 bases. Alright, let's talk about convoys and resources. There are no resource sites on the map as well. There are also no citizens. So you can only gain resources by making sure that your convoys reach their destination. So later there will be convoys sent from the USA to Australia. You have to protect them, and when they reach the destination, you get resources. And also later, when you sink Japanese convoys, then you will also get resources simply to represent the shifting balance of power. So you can unlock units. The more bases you capture, the more units become available. Same you can see in the section 2.3. Right? You told me you really were tough. And then you start squawking. 2.3, this is where you can see from how many bases you can unlock what units. So what else do we have here? Special units. So this map was specifically designed to utilize marine raiders. This will be the partisans and the UDTs, the underwater demolition teams, which will be the SAS commandos, right? So you can often use their skills to approach bases from dead angles and capture flag. That means flags. When you capture a flag, it neutralizes all the defensive installations, right? You can do this without endangering your ships or planes or your regular soldiers. So bamboo towers are very strong against ships, I don't know why, but that's how it is. And AA guns have extended range, so you have to be really careful with your ships near enemy island bases. So what they can do, marine raiders can move through woods as partisans can. And they have been buffed so that they can run much faster and they'll be able to take on regular infantry easily. The UDTs, the SAS commandos, they can swim, of course. When you are close to a mine, they will defuse that mine. They can also plant explosives, of course. So these explosives, as in the original game, they deal 1500 damage, so they can take out many defensive structures just in one go. That means, yeah, they cannot take out concrete towers, but they cannot take out bamboo towers, they can take out pillboxes, they can take out AA guns, right? And they deal area damage. One, or sometimes 1.5 additional squares around the place where they were planted, right? So remember that you don't have to get very close to a building, you just need to plant that explosive somewhere near, and then it can also reach the defensive building and also deal 1500 damage. Okay, and they will deal full damage also beyond walls, right? That makes sure that you can take out defensive installations even when you are on the other side of a wall, right? Because when you put an SAS commando in front of a tower, it will often kill him immediately before he can even reach it. So you can keep on the other side of walls, because towers cannot shoot through walls when you are very close. Then you can plant the explosive near that wall and it will take out the defensive tower on the other side as well. Right, so you don't need any direct line of fire with explosives. Right, you be careful with the UDTs because they can swim, but of course they can swim slowly, and I think it also makes much more sense to put them on transports when you transport them over these vast expanses of the ocean. But then when you unload them, be careful because it can cause a crash. So don't unload the SAS when you are somewhere near water when there is no island, or when there is a lot of water around, even when you are close to an island, because it can cause a crash. Because, well, of course, there is no animation for the SAS dropping into the water from a boat and then continuing swimming, right? So you need to put him, you need to unload him onto land together with many other units with the unload button. Then, so you have to make sure there is enough land inside. And let the song keep us strong. Yeah, try before you unload any UDT from a transport, try to save the game. Remember how we used to call them? Alright, so something I'm really proud of here: sandbags, tanks, and cover. So human units near sandbags and tanks will gain 500 extra hit points and one extra range unit. That goes for the Marines, machine guns, and UDTs. We found and out just what all that talk was worth. If you want to make a unit take cover, right, just move it near sandbag or near the tanks, we'll and then have it unselected and not moving, right? So don't have it selected and don't move it around. And then the unit will take on the hold ground stance and also will be transferred to player 2, USA ally, right? That's an ally because that way I can give him extra range without influencing the class of your other units. If you want to get out of the cover, then select one of the units, and that particular unit will get out of cover after a few seconds, or select the sandbag, and all the units will get out of cover that are near that sandbag. Actually, on the whole map, right? But then they will revert to cover a few seconds later. And if it's a tank, you can just move the tank away from the unit, or you can move the unit away from the tank. It will have the same effect. Okay. So, enemy units behind sandbags have 500 hit points as well, extra hit points, so, yeah. Just be careful when you have some units that have taken too much damage while they are in cover, they will disappear when they are transferred back to player 1, right? So, when a unit is at very low health, and then you take it out of cover, then they will completely disappear because it will deduce those 500 hit points again. Right, also be careful when you have an engineer building a pillbox near sandbags so that he doesn't get stuck in the cover of the sandbag, right? Because he's stationary and while he's constructing, and if you click somewhere else and don't have him selected, he will be put under cover and under player 2 control. That means he will stop building your pillbox. And you will lose the resources. The resources are very scarce on this map. In this scenario, so have an engineer selected all the time when you are building something, especially when you are near sandbags, right? And this is just a list of all the island groups and how many flags there are belonging to this island group or to this base, right? So your initial bases have only one flag each. So if a Japanese unit comes near that flag, they immediately capture the whole island group. These are your four initial bases: USA, Hawaii, Midway, and Port Moresby, and the rest belongs to Japan. And there you can see how many flags there are belonging to each of these bases. All right, and that's it.